Okay, let's see who comes. Thanks for the people logging on. We're just going to give everybody a few minutes to get set up and settled, and I'll introduce the night. Well, a couple more minutes to get logged on. All right, well, I'm going to just get started. People can jump in as they find the links. I know a couple places they had to go to a couple different links, but they'll all get here, I'm sure. So thank you very much for joining us tonight at Holy Family Community Center's first online event. We are dying to host people here in this gorgeous chapel and hopefully have these kind of screenings live where we can get together and talk. But for now, I love the opportunity to present this online. So my name is Lori Tatro. I am the Director of Programs here at Holy Family Community Center. I work for the Society of St. Vincent de Paul, who took their over the offices here, brought their offices here maybe a couple years ago. And as Holy Family's parish was dwindling down to 10 people, they ended up merging with St. Francis Cabrini. And the society took over the care and feeding of the building and the people outside, basically. We have a sack lunch we offer at the door Monday through Friday and clothes that you can get and personal care items also Monday through Friday now. In the future, the chapel will host all kinds of events like this, storytelling, plays, concerts, dinners down in our social hall. We have a community garden outside. This is have two successful years under our belts. We have through the society, we have a food pantry and 4 thrift stores you probably know us for. So a lot of exciting things. Our work has not stopped this year. We have ramped up even more than ever. So we appreciate finding opportunities like this to connect with people and to get them to connect with each other when we're all so isolated. And so we have opportunities for people to volunteer safely. We have beautiful grounds you can come and see and hang out. We've taken all the asbestos tile out of the building. The floors are in the middle of being refinished. So it's just going to be a gorgeous space when we can get back together. So again, thanks for coming to this screening of Art21. It's a PBS series that's been going for, what is it now, 20 years. And they do documentary style video of artists all over the world, contemporary artists working today. You get to see them and hear them talk about their work in their studios and in the communities they work in. These folks tonight in particular work along the border between Mexico and America. So the episode is called Borderlands. And I've invited some panelists locally and not so locally to talk with us about the episode. Like to introduce Rachel Adams from the Bemis Center and Misael Soto. It was a Bemis resident recently and is now many different places around the country. And Karin Campbell is our curator at the Joslyn of Contemporary Work. So thank you all so much for joining us. We are gonna screen the episode live right now. We do have the chat open. If you have questions and comments, we'll keep an eye out, but we will have the discussion immediately following, and then we'll open it up to questions and we'll just keep an eye on that chat. So thanks again for coming and enjoy.
Okay, I'm gonna share my screen and start the video.
Someone said that art, it's the only profession that you could, you know, play like a kid when you're a grown 52-year-old.
It's looking pretty good out here.
Looking good. This could be our opportunity.
Yeah, I think this is it.
Estas partes del muro, mira, se caen. Si uno le pega, se empieza a caer el muro. ¿Me quieres ayudar a colectar?
We're starting lights today.
Okay, cool. We're ready.
Okay, copy.
Just follow me and I'll let you know if I see a snake.
On first look, a lot of my work can look like it's documentary or social documentary, But I go to great lengths to make them really transcend just being a mere fact. I want to make them so beautiful that you have to look and think about them. To really slow down and consider and just think, this doesn't look right. Is it right?
I grew up in Tijuana, on the border with San Diego. I would cross the border every day to go to school in the US. As a child, I was constantly being marked by my border identity. Not belonging to anybody, not belonging to like the US or Mexico.
¿Esos son mensajes que trae de allá?
Sí, que los niños en Los Ángeles escribieron.
¿Niños?
Sí, entonces son mensajes de niños a niños. Nuestro gobierno no refleja los sentimientos de la mayoría de los americanos. Estamos con ustedes. Amor entre los niños, no hay fronteras. A lot of my work is about visibility and is about more representation and having more people see themselves or their struggles mirrored. I think the borderlands mean like really opposing things to people. For a lot of us that have grown up there and kind of seen the effects of living next to the border on the Mexican side, I kind of experienced it a lot as a place of death. Like a desecration of land as a place that divides families, as a place that sadly a lot of people perish at because of their thought of the borderlands as being a place of hope. Like the promised land, this place where you make a migration north and you end up in this place that is more beautiful than anything you've ever imagined. But for the most part, people kind of get smacked with just the reality of the border wall. And I think that constant influx of new groups of people coming into the border makes the borderlands a really experimental place for how societies can recreate themselves.
Hola.
Pues estoy moliendo pedazos del muro. ¿Me puede ayudar a hacer uno?
Vale.
I think photography is a magical, powerful medium. We all take pictures of our loved ones and vacations and things like that. But then when you use it in a way that transcends that level, it does bear witness like no other medium. Over the years, I've photographed many different kinds of cultural activities where nature and culture collide. It wasn't until I worked in the open American desert that I felt like I found my niche. In a funny way, our culture stands out in very clear relief in the desert. I discovered things like military bombing ranges, the nuclear test site, space shuttle landings, man-made fires, man-made floods. I started working on these projects of just photographing landscapes with traces of human civilization in it. I was constantly reconciling this idea of the beauty of the place and ugliness exists side by side in the American Desert West. But to me, that was a part of America that anything that showed up there told you about larger American issues and global ones for that matter. Essentially, what I do over the years is I just travel the American desert and wander around and look for new projects, new ideas. And I just saw this photograph of this blue barrel and the blue flag in the middle of nowhere. I just photographed it. I didn't even know what it was. It wasn't until many years later I learned that different humanitarian groups would put water out for migrants coming across the border. I decided to do a whole series of them. And I would find these in every state. You know, California, Arizona, New Mexico, and Texas. So this photograph was the first one that gave me the idea that's kind of became the border cantos. So I spent the next 5 years traveling along the US-Mexico border from the coast where the wall goes into the ocean all the way to the Texas Gulf of Mexico. One of the things I've learned from this series is that until you go see this place yourself, you have no idea what's really going on there.
When I look at the borderlands, I see a clear demarcation of colonization. That's the underlining meaning of that border.
Post-commodity was founded as an interdisciplinary indigenous artist collective.
We've got to start including an indigenous worldview in relationship to the border.
The idea of the balloons is to intersect the US-Mexico border. That signified a suturing or connecting of the Americas together.
In indigenous cultures, this eye means an open eye, an eye that's aware, an eye that's knowledgeable, but also an eye that is accountable.
These are places where indigenous children from all throughout Latin America have journeyed to on their own in search of some kind of safety, only to find themselves imprisoned in some of the most unsafe spaces on Earth.
Fully dehumanized.
Fully dehumanized, just like our ancestors. This work is testimony that the indigenous people presupposed this hard edge border. Suturing is remembering.
And human.
And reasserting one's place on the land. The idea that you can take a side of contest, conflict, and controversy, and reimagine it into a place of curiosity where people can sense the world and share those experiences with one another. That's what overrides that baser hunger for justice.
Yo asumo que si ustedes están aquí es porque les interesa el arte de los nerds. Yo soy un nerd muy consagrado, ¿no? Me interesa muchísimo la ciencia. Si quieren empezar, vamos a entrar en los cuartos todos juntos y lo hacemos por módulos.
Many of my works involve this process of taking a portrait of a participant, for example, like their face or their fingerprint or their heartbeat, and then making it into a landscape. We because it's beautiful to see your heartbeat, but it's more beautiful to see it in relationship to all these others. That's the kind of complexity that I'm interested in evoking.
Esta es una obra que se llama Pabellón de Ampliaciones. Entonces, lo que hace esta pieza no es nada más seguir, hacer un seguimiento de cada persona, sino la relación entre dos personas. Esas son todas las grabaciones que están sucediendo ahorita, que le dicen al sistema cuánto tiempo estuviste, qué tan lejos de la persona estuviste y si eso fue una actividad sospechosa o no. La vigilancia computarizada es algo ya totalmente establecido, ¿no? Y la idea es, si tú de repente actualizas esa vigilancia con los conceptos autoritarios, ¿qué es lo que sucedería? Bueno, seguimos al siguiente cuarto, por favor.
We're living in a society where these technologies are inescapable. In the context of the border, having surveillance systems all over, the searchlights of the Border Patrol choppers looking for migrants. A lot of the work that I do with technology is a perversion of their original intent to create critical or poetic responses.
I'm a Mexican immigrant in Canada. But when I would hear the Trump administration talk about Mexicans being rapists, using Mexicans as this escape valve for all this hatred, you feel that. You feel that personally.
Now more than ever, when these nationalisms come in, is when art is required. Is required to establish dialogue, to ask questions, to bring people together, you know? And it sounds a little bit naive, but in the history of art, it's always been the case. I felt, okay, this is time to come up with a work that can make a contribution to the area.
Oh, that's cool.
The work that I'm doing now, Border Tuner, would present this continuous symbolic bridge across El Paso and Ciudad Juarez, using searchlights not to look for individuals, but rather to look for relationships between individuals.
When I started thinking about a new project, I just kept thinking about like the heaviness of bearing witness to these really horrible things on the border. I wanted to make a piece to physically expel these things that I had unearthed and this scar that I, you know, kept digging open and digging open. The glass pieces make up a suit. The headpiece is inspired by Mesoamerican imagery. The huarache is designed to fail. So it's designed so that as I walk in it, it starts to break. When I was little, I never knew that art was a career path. I never knew that that was something that you could really do. It wasn't until I was in community college and I met my mentor, Michael Schnorr, who was one of the original founders of the Border Art Workshop. Michael had been working to make a stance against Operation Gatekeeper.
We are a nation of immigrants, and we should all be proud of it. But we're also a nation of laws.
Operation Gatekeeper was the strategic reinforcement of the U.S.-Mexico border.
We're beginning to see a movement of the traffic away from the urban area itself out to the perimeter. That is our objective here.
It forced migrants to cross through the desert rather than jumping across and running through residential areas.
The first year that they enacted Operation Gatekeeper, more people died crossing the border than the entire 75 years of Border Patrol history. Michael was showing us how people were using art to make political statements, to change society, but then also talking about the physical space of the border as like a theater for discussion. I started thinking more about taking back the fence and changing it from being a space of pain and trauma into a generative place that we can reclaim. After I left San Diego and Tijuana for a long time, I thought about how to help shape the narrative about the border that was currently happening during the 2016 election. So I founded AMBOS, which stands for Art Made Between Opposite Sides.
Masculino, no identificado. Masculino, sin identidad.
I wanted to work collaboratively with other people, using the border as a starting point for that conversation. We did a project called the Border Kipu.
Arte gratis. Sí, porque estamos haciendo un proyecto de arte. Estamos viendo todas las ciudades fronterizas y le estamos preguntando a la gente que qué piensa cuando cruza la frontera o qué piensa acerca de vivir en la frontera. Y luego lo que le pedimos también es que nos haga un nudo simbólico.
The Andean pre-Columbian system of the Kipu were calendars, counting system, language, but I wanted to use it to visualize our connection to each other, recording our like daily migrations to the north, and also physically represent the bodies of all the people that participated in the project. What are your thoughts when you cross this border? Economicamente es una ciudad que tiene una gran capacidad de crecimiento. Sometimes I think about how much time I spend here or if my son will have to do this too. No me gustaría cruzar por cómo está la política, pero en México está peor y es necesario cruzar. We ended up having close to 10,000 people participate in the Border Kipu. That taught me so much about the vastness of our community on the border, but also the many ways that governments, not just in US and Mexico, but you know, all over, have failed to protect people.
When you look at a border wall in Tijuana, on the Mexico side, people are partying. They're swimming, they're building sandcastles, they're having barbecues, they're just very festive. And on the US side, nobody uses this beautiful beach. So there was a lot of irony in this photograph for me. Looks like a prison cell, but we're on the wrong side of the wall, or the prison cell. When I first started making serious photographs, I wasn't thinking about social documentary or political work, but because I was exposed to everything around me in the late 60s, the whole world was just going wild with politics. I saw this kind of idea of taking these tools, this language of fine art photography, and applying it to the street. I lived in Berkeley right off of Telegraph Avenue. One night, got my camera and my tripod that I use for landscape work, and then I just started photographing people. And I began the Telegraph 3AM project that way. But once the book came out, I started realizing that I thought I was going to change the world with this work by showing people things that they hadn't seen before. But in fact, it just helped my career. That just felt wrong. After Telegraph 3 a.m., when I was kind of disillusioned with my own work, I said, I'm not going to photograph people. And I was looking kind of in search of the miraculous. Rather than thinking about the political world, I wanted to go and remove myself from it all and just go on this journey. I just got this idea one night, cactus with these mystical forms in the desert, and then I was going to go and photograph them. And I started photographing at night and experimenting. Not yet, but soon. I really liked working at night. It gave me a fresh language that very few people had ever used in photography. That was that moment. That was it. I'm getting chills, actually. For me, that became a place where my mind just took off. I had fallen in love with the desert. I was in my mid-20s. I didn't know at that point that I would ever be thinking about the political consequences of the desert. And then some years later, I'm back in that same territory, but looking at border issues that were facing and threatening the very same landscape. The desert was a vast stage where everything that happened there kind of projects onto the rest of America.
I grew up in north central New Mexico, more specifically the upper Rio Grande Valley, which is a high desert. My primary discourse is in the land itself. And so being away from the borderlands is being diasporic. And it's hard to be diasporic in the world.
Wow, it's pretty sick to watch.
Yeah.
You know, it's like a little dance.
We're in the middle of one of the largest migrations of peoples from the south to the north. Here in Chicago, there are currently over 750,000 people in the county who are of Mexican descent. And that number is growing, will continue to grow. So the expectation is that the landscape is going to be transformed culturally, politically, socially. We wanted to build a piece to mark that time, that this transformation is happening, this migration is happening.
Any second now. I feel like someone's going to wave the checkered flag.
10 years ago, I met these guys at the Arizona State University Art Museum. They had a slab of the concrete floor cut and mounted on a pedestal. And then they suspended a microphone over the earth beneath and had a speaker with a native peeposh ceremony being played at a very low volume. So as you walked in, you weren't sort of struck by the sound until you got a little bit closer. The project was very related to the land literally beneath the museum, and that was burial grounds. They seemed to always be able to find something very interesting about the site where they were working. Considering what's been going on and the border. I was really interested to see what they might think about in the context of Chicago, now all of us being sort of away from the border.
Throughout all of Latin America, you oftentimes will find these columns that are projecting off the rooftops of homes. And a lot of times people who are not from Latin America misinterpret the meaning of those columns. They think that the homes are unfinished.
Es un castillo para nosotros. Así le llamamos. Vamos una columna fuerte por donde se va a levantar un edificio grande. La típica de que después ahórrale y después vamos a hacer el segundo piso. Esa es la típica. Siempre dicen eso y siempre quedan esos castillos ahí a punto del segundo piso. Algunas veces se logran y algunas veces no.
What the columns often signify is a pragmatic approach to growth. As the family expands, the home expands. And so the house is always growing, always emergent.
This piece and the skyline that surrounds it, it's a way to acknowledge a very strong Mexican cultural tradition being established here in Chicago.
That's why art is so useful, because it's non-didactic. It's more of an opportunity to dance as opposed to having to engage in some form of war.
Voz Alta was a work in Mexico City to commemorate the 40th anniversary of the massacre of students in Tlatelolco Plaza. We set up a megaphone that converted people's voices into light. So these very powerful searchlights would come flashing to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs.
Yo pregunté alguna vez, ¿por qué solamente esos nombres en esa lápida? Me contestaron que fueron solamente los cuerpos que lograron reconocer.
Recuerdo que participé en todas las marchas y casualmente en el 2 de octubre no me dieron permiso en mi casa de venir y no sé, a lo mejor por eso estoy ahorita participando de mi experiencia. Me emociona bastante esta situación y no sé, actualmente estamos viendo que es necesario que sigamos luchando, participando y no cejar en esta lucha.
Now speak without leaning.
Hi, this is a test.
Okay, and now lean.
And now it sounds better.
This microphone. Creating a platform for people to self-represent, for their voice to be visible, is a fundamental part of what I'm doing politically.
Well, that's what we had before.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So 0.001.
Whoa. So go to 0.1. If I'm crossing somebody else's lights, automatically the computer opens a bidirectional channel of communication. So now you can hear me and I can hear you.
Mic in and sending it off.
Whereas Voz Alta was more about speaking to the heavens, Border Tuner is about speaking to another person, establishing these new connections to create community.
Siento en el alma un vacío, uno que no puedo llenar.
I like to take people up to this lookout because it's one of the places where you can really get a sense of how the two cities fit together. So should we get up and have a look around?
Yeah, let's do it.
Juarez and El Paso together make up the largest binational metropolis in the Western Hemisphere. So that's the border that you see there. It's this big, wide stretch like running through. And from here you can see our site also. So you can see Bowie High School And just across the trees are the Chamisal, which was a bi-national park at one point. It's a particularly integrated place. More than 65% of the people in both cities have immediate family in the other city, so 65%.
I love when you have a pre-established notion of what you're gonna see, and it's wrong. I learned that you can't make an artwork about the wall. People there are sick of the wall. They want to talk about the ways in which the two societies interpenetrate. To create an artwork for listening is really what the project became.
Hola, probando.
Jeffrey, you can run the streaming interface in here, is that true?
I can run it over here, yes.
Oh, this is really good then. Live stream.
So I can see here all of the different attributes of that station, whether I need to ignite the light or things like that.
Okay. Aquí derechito están los otros compañeros del otro lado?
Sí.
Justo, justo así.
Están exactamente enfrente. Es como espejo.
Hey, Jeffrey, for fun, let's start the lights early.
Going into performance mode.
Here we go, lights up. Boom. Whoa. Whoa. Thanks for joining us. Muchas gracias a todos por acompañarnos. Starting now, the mics are interactive, so anyone who wants to try them out, come on in.
You wanna try moving the lights? All the way over there. There, you can stop right there and say hello.
Hello? Hola?
Hola, ¿cómo te llamas?
Salvador.
Salvador?
Sí.
¿Cuántos años tienes?
Siete.
Wow, yo tengo 22.
Rafael has mentioned that he was not here to create connections. He was here to highlight the connections that were already in place. But I don't think that's the case. I really think like there were like some interesting connections created in between both communities.
¿Cuántos años tienes? Yo tengo 26. ¿Y tú?
Es que estás hablando con un viejito de 70 años.
Ah, no,
no,
está bien.
Yo viví mucho tiempo ahí en Juárez. Nosotros tenemos algún tiempo que no vamos a Juárez.
¿Y eso por qué ha dejado de visitar Ciudad Juárez? Por temor. Ya también he estado igual allá. Yo tengo a mi madre y a mi hermano ya. Tengo años sin verlos. Pero sé que están bien. Gracias a Dios.
Te invitamos a que nos visites al paso. Un día, sí.
There's a lot of people who live in El Paso who have never been to Mexico, or vice versa. Because there is this kind of dehumanization of what is going on there. When you speak one-to-one with someone, it completely changes your perception.
If we don't see people apprehended and brought back to their countries, if we see these massive caravans coming up, we're gonna tariff the cars. And if that doesn't work, we're gonna close the border. But I think that'll work.
Y esos van a ser bebés para que los niños aprendan a cuidar cosas and so they can learn how to take care of their friends. Just like you learned, ¿verdad? After having a child, I now think about the world you leave to somebody else. Ni siquiera se puede bañar allí. You can keep it in there. I have a responsibility now beyond responsibility to myself. Knowing that has really affected the work that I do, thinking about how to be more empathetic and thinking about what it means to be part of a community. The glass performance piece, mm-hmm. The date is already set for when I'm doing the performance. We need to talk about all of the physical training required to carry all of the...
Thrilled.
Yeah, to carry all of the glass. After the border keeper, I kept thinking of carrying this like open scar from the border with me, like everywhere I go, and having my whole life shaped by it. Do we have a third one, or should we just try with two? All of this like heavy memory. What do you do with it, and how do you process it? How does the body, like, you know, deal with it? Try it. Okay.
I can fix the bone.
The piece is called Metabolizing the Border. I wanted to make a piece that would force my body to deal with the border through all of the five senses. So you're forced to see through the fence only. You're forced to breathe through the fence only. You're forced to hear through particles of the border fence.
Okay, you're good?
Yeah. You can't escape the border. I'm going to be walking back and forth along the border on the US side, wearing all of these glass pieces. In a lot of the work that I do, I engage communities, but this piece, it's a personal piece that I want to do for myself. Okay. I'm excited to do the performance and to see how I feel after. I don't know if in the end it'll be something that's cathartic to put out there what I've been carrying invisibly. I want to see the pictures.
Yeah.
It looks like a really weird ass alien baby señora. Okay. I'm like anxious. I'm nervous about the like physical demand on my body, and I'm nervous about like the emotional demand. But yeah.
Look out in the distance there, you can see the end of the wall. So it's gonna take a little while to drive there, but we're on our way to the wall's end. It just stops abruptly. And there's not a Border Patrol agent in sight. There's only 680 miles of actual wall along the 2,000-mile border, and they generally put them in areas that are densely populated. And the idea is that if they push people out to the ends, it'd be so dangerous for them to cross into wilderness area that they would die. So it would be so dangerous that people wouldn't go. It would discourage people from actually going across the border. That didn't work. In fact, more people have died since they built these walls with these ends. Thank you. It's a beautiful landscape here. It's just kind of remarkable how lovely and lyrical the landscape is. And it's weird to have the wall just kind of breaking it up. It seems sinister. When I first met Guillermo, he was performing an instrument that he had created that he had made out of objects found on the border. I had just photographed the effigies along the border, and my light went off. I went, oh my God, this could be a great collaboration.
It's interesting because we have the same aesthetic and the same way to approach the border issues. If you see Art of the Border, sometimes it's about taking certain political view about it. But our work is more about opening spaces, it's about absence. People is not there, you know, it's just the evidence of what happens. What keeps happening.
You take a minute, stop and think about this crucifix that you find. Why is that there? What were they running from? Each one evokes its own story. I want them to be like scenes of the crime. So I would photograph them often just with my cell phone, straight on, just like evidence. And then Guillermo turned them into instruments.
The ways in which music heals in Mesoamerican cultures, you find an object that has a connection to a person and you make an instrument out of that and you heal with that. Art is many things, but one of the things that art does is opens imagination and it opens new ways of seeing things or hearing things. It's very important to see new ways because if not, we're stuck with the same all the time.
The wall has become this dark symbol, like a barricade that keeps people out. Where the Statue of Liberty is a monument to positive American values, the border wall is an anti-monument. It's exact opposite. All my photographs are about America, and that's both the challenges that it faces, but also its beauties. It's an exquisite land, it's an exquisite country, and the future of the country depends a lot on how we think about places like this.
The border is a place where we go through a lot of difficult stuff, but we learn how to deal with it. I've learned to compare people here like desert plants. They live in the harshest conditions, but once they bloom, they're one of the most beautiful plants. And I feel like that's how humans are here. We're super resilient.
Somos el último, ¿no? Los últimos o sí, todavía hay alguien más.
No, ya es lo último.
Es como una llamada, pues sí. No le hace que ella me interrumpa, ella le interrumpa.
No, pero no, no es, es una conversación como si estuvieran así, cara a cara.
Hola, buenas noches, Ciudad Juárez y El Paso, Texas. Soy chicano, fronterizo. Antes me llamaban joto, maricón, puto. La boca es la más poderosa y puedo matar a gente con mi boca. Pero ahora la uso para la sanación.
que tengo mucho que regalar.
This idea of like to love your neighbor, be kind to the people who are around you. I think most Americans do that quite well, when someone's actually standing in front of their face. But the problem is that we don't have a handle about how to be human at a global scale. Here in a place like Juarez in El Paso, you see the actual real effects on human lives, the connections behind the goods that we buy, the connections behind our foreign policy in other places. All of that comes to a head right here at the US-Mexico border, where you actually can look face to face at the other human being.
Party to people. Are you coming to party? Guys, there's Mexicans trying to communicate. You must touch us. So you put your hands on it. The one on the right is the Mexican heartbeat. The one on the left is the one for me. And what I feel in my hands is the heartbeat of the person on the other side. Quick, put your hands. So now you feel their heartbeat. And they feel yours.
Pero es lindo.
Sí.
Sentido el corazón.
The beauty of us working together, it's incredibly powerful.
Salud. Salud.
We feel that in order to have a world, we need to divide ourselves from one another. But that love we get to experience oftentimes when we're making art together. It sort of restored in a lot of ways our faith in humanity.
There's a lot of artists who want to create artificial realities that then we can go and dream inside of, where all of a sudden you can be other than yourself and just kind of experience like a field of butterflies. Well, this doesn't really work in the real world. At this time, it's kind of like the Zapatistas say, you know, we're not asking you to dream, we're asking you to wake up.
Yet we stopped the last one. You see what's going on in Tijuana.
Did you sleep okay? It's really hard to fall asleep.
Doesn't matter, but we need a very strong structure.
History does tend to repeat itself.
It's really hard to know 20 years from now what will we have learned and what will we do differently. But I do believe that by making formally beautiful pictures of this, no matter what, this work will stand as a record for this moment, and hopefully will be something that will inform people in the future.
Help me pull this part up a little bit more.
There is a really incredibly pertinent need for us to keep talking about the border, to keep exploring what the border is and what the border can do to a person's body.
can I stop? When can I stop?
I've got this.
Like, would I make it? Would I make it if I had to, like, make that journey? And if I had to be lost in the desert for 2 weeks, could I make it? Okay, like, you have enough on you. Like, you don't have to try to put more on you.
Exijo un momento de silencio por todas las voces que nunca llegaron. Que nadie olvide su voz, sus latidos de corazón.
It's a heavy burden. We're artists and we're trying to sense the world and learn from it. And through our idiosyncratic lens, share it back out with the world. Well, here's our lens. Take a look at the world through it and tell us what you think.
Just don't walk away from it prematurely. Just give it time.
Give it a chance.
Mm-hmm. Just give it some time.
Que no pienso en ti, te diré. Que no pienso en ti. Que no llamo por ti, te diré.
Art in the 21st Century Season 10 is available on Amazon Prime Video. This program was made possible by the National Endowment for the Arts, Lamben Foundation, the Anna Maria and Stephen Kellen Foundation, the Andy Warhol Foundation for the Visual Arts, Toby Devin Lewis, the Horace W. Goldsmith Foundation, Henri Lambert, Nyan McAvoy and Leslie Berriman, Sakana Foundation, and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Oh, so many thoughts. I know every time I watch this, I focus on different things, and it's all about storytelling to me. Artists telling their story through their work, and here we get to hear the words behind the motivations. So I shared a favorite quote in the chat, something I really needed to hear today, but I can't wait to hear what everybody else has to think. So just jump in and give us your reactions.
Who wants to go first? I just realized I was not muted. So used to being muted.
I don't mind jumping in because there's something that, so I think this is now the third or fourth time I've watched this, and the same exact kind of overriding theme or narrative has hit me really every time, which is this real upending of the expected narrative of what the border is and what the border is about. And I think Ms. Rock pretty early on encapsulates that, and we can get into maybe at some point potential issues with his work, but he has this statement, you know, I want people to look at these things and say, this doesn't look right. Is that right? And you hear sort of echoes of that idea in the various manifestations of this concept and the other artists. But that's this idea that the border can be transformed from a place of loss into a place of generative power, I think really ties into that. And those things, those kind of interconnected themes are what really have struck me each time.
Yeah, I think that, you know, especially Tanya's work in particular really sticks with me so much. I don't know if it's, just in the beginning when you see the sort of messages from the children in, you know, the US to the children in Mexico, or, you know, just like the, what is it called? The Ambos Project, where she, you know, there's sort of 10,000 people having contributed, like, you know, these thoughts about the border. I don't know. There's something, you know, not having, you know, I lived in Texas for 5 years, but I didn't live anywhere close to the border. And so not really having, you know, that personal experience, but really like feeling that through some of the things that, you know, she recites in that. And then her own personal journey wearing that, those sculptures is just like, to me, like I can like feel the weight, you know? And I recently, one of our former residents, Kevin Cooley, did a really amazing photography piece on, you know, on the border a few months ago. Really follow, you know, the story was not his, but he was the sort of journalist in it, and just the photograph similar to some of the ones that you see with Mizrock, but like in a different way. But, you know, it just like you feel the weight, you know, like those water barrels, like thinking about things like that, like water in particular is something that really like strikes me through some of this as well. But I don't know, there is a lot to think about for sure.
Yeah, I think for me, again, also it was maybe the third or fourth time I've seen this. And obviously coming to this as an artist, I'm gonna think a lot about method, like, and kind of comparing the different artists, even amongst the four of them. And of course, then also my practice being very invested in a alternative, let's say, to a gallery minded or museum minded kind of work. And so I kind of end up inadvertently ranking the artists. But I think regardless of how that ranking is in my head, and maybe we'll get into that, all of them have this kind of what I would call like embodied research methodology. I mean, they're all there at the site. They're all, you know, despite the fact that, you know, Mizrock's photographs are then sold at Pace or wherever he shows, he's there and he's kind of trying to figure it out on the job, on the site. And they each kind of have that. And I think Raphael and Tanya in particular, really, and some of the earlier post-commodity work. And it, you know, it kind of gets into the, what I would call where art becomes data. And I really like this term that I tend to use, which is affective data. Like it's data and like a kind of scientific research that is outside of known scientific forms and circles, where like art is really like now in the 21st century, as Art21 says, it is kind of trying to kind of circle back and be like real again. And I think a lot of these were doing that in really interesting ways.
Yeah,
go ahead, Rachel.
No, I was just gonna say, I think that in the beginning, one of the post-commodity guys, when they're talking about the repellent fence piece, which I think is an unbelievable piece and a great film, if anybody wants to rent that on, I think Amazon has it and other places. A friend of mine, Sam Douglas, did it, and it's unbelievably followed. He worked with them for like several years to do that documentary, but he called it, they were suturing. And I thought that was such an interesting term, and it made me really think. Also, I think Raphael's work does that unbelievably, you know, with both the voice pieces, but then also there's the pulse piece, which he just like, oh, and then there's this pulse piece here, you could do this. And I was like, that to me also is such a powerful way to, you know, exactly what you're saying, is sort of like become real again and like touch somebody else's heart, you know? So yeah, anyway, that was just the suturing part really like thought, like killed me in a way, like in a good way. Like I love thinking about it that way.
Yeah. I think Misa, you brought up a great point about the kind of varied approaches or methodologies for what it is to think through the wall. And you know, this, the tension, I think to me, there's a real tension in this particular Art21 between confronting the reality and the objecthood of the wall, kind of head on, which is what Tanya is doing in her work, versus, you know, Raphael actually says, you can't make an artwork about the wall. People are sick of it. And she would really beg to differ, right? But like, but in the end, for me kind of personally, they are the most moving of the projects featured in this particular documentary, and feel the most human, even though they're coming at what it is to be human and to experience physical space in a very different way.
Yeah, definitely. I would agree. I had a thought, having done a lot of work with the climate crisis, and how now getting into like second and third iterations of trying to solve these issues, where, you know, in a place like Miami, where I usually live, I'm not there now, where walls are now failing, where walls have been built in places like London and Tokyo, and they're gonna start to fail as well. Walls are failing us everywhere, and they're actually aggravating the problems. They're a false sense of security. And so I found this parallel interesting, because it's exactly what Raphael was saying, and it's exactly what I think a lot of the other artists are kind of saying through their work, which is that we have to think about it and deal with it in this regard, an artistic way to think about it, right, through that new lens, through these new ways that then force us to re-examine, to think of these things more holistically.
Yeah. Walls certainly failed us yesterday. Mm-hmm. That's a very timely statement. Not that it's funny, but it just feels very on the nose. So you touch on something else that I think is sort of a theme reiterated throughout, which is the necessity of art to make us look at the world in a different way. I mean, each of them, there's a refrain like this kind of for each of the artists. I think the first to articulate it is Raphael, when he says art is required. Post-commodity says art is useful. Mizrock talks about making, or his collaborator, the composer, talks about making us look at the world in a different way. So I think that ties into my initial reaction of upending the expectations or narratives of this site.
Yeah, I think that the sort of like useful and necessary comments, you know, obviously like we are all in the arts here, so we believe that to our core, I would hope, you know. But I think when you see it in a way that, you know, even with the post-commodity, with the guys on the roof and like the, you know, when they interview the one worker and he like immediately knows exactly like what this is, and, you know, thinking about the family and the expansion of the family and the expansion of people like north, and, you know, they talked about the sort of transformation of the landscape through migration, which I thought was like something that I think we all know, but maybe just like even saying those words, like that to me feels like, yeah, and because of that, you know, having artists that can connect and, you know, specifically like bridge the, you know, cultures in many different ways, I think is like really, you know, part of this for me. I think especially like that piece, which I'm not like, it's not my favorite thing that they've done, but watching this again, I was kind of like, okay, you know, I can get behind this now. Like, I do think that there is something here. I might not like the title of the piece, but, you know, but yeah, really, again, like thinking about that, the movement of people and the movement of like culture and how we are intersecting all the time, and how, you know, yeah, like there shouldn't be so many walls, right? Like they do fail to protect us, and maybe they don't need to, you know, and sort of thinking through ideas of that to me is something that kind of is coming up.
Yeah, that idea of the mutual impact between landscape and migration, I think is really quite interesting. So if you think about many of the global migrations that have happened since in history are either tied to something like civil war, strife, or some kind of climate crisis. So like the civil war in Syria was in part because of a brutal authoritarian regime, but they were also in the middle of a multi-year drought and people didn't have food. And when people don't have food, they get angry. And what happens when people get angry, there are power vacuums, you know? And so you see the climate impacting or forcing migration, and then you see migration changing the landscape implicitly, even by the like the things left by people who have not made, who have not been successful in the trip from Mexico across the border. So that's, it's interesting that you pulled that out from the post-commodity one, because I was not thinking about that one in that way, but it's the same sort of narrative.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that, you know, it's something that, yeah, like the movement of people, obviously, like, you know, and globalization and all of these things that are sort of shaped our landscape, but like actually thinking about the physical landscape too. I mean, I think that's what, you know, I really love, you know, personally, like the thing that I gravitate in Mizrock's photographs is like the actual like landscape, right? And like, you know, he talks about that. He's like, this is a beautiful landscape. And it really is, you know, and even the Raphael's, one of his, the guy they interviewed, I can't remember his name, you know, talked about the people being like a desert plant and the cactus and the sort of like resilience, you know? And I think that is really something that I see, you know, even in Tanya's performance, like that idea of, you know, and when it blooms, it is like the most beautiful thing, right? Like when a cactus blooms and it's like kind of unexpected and really like super strong and important. So yeah, I think I'm like saying a bunch of things, but I do really think that there is something about like the actual like landscape that is really stunning, but that can be obviously like such a deadly thing to so many people. And, you know, how do we sort of work with that now? And yeah, how it's like just pushing people, you know, north in a way that it will continue to do because of things like climate change and strife and, you know, poverty. So, yeah.
Yeah, they're only gonna, you know, the things that make these spaces deadly are only gonna get worse with climate change. And with, you know, geopolitical issues being as they are, the borders are there for a reason, you know, like they landed there, so to speak, for a reason. And so we have to tell ourselves that, you know, there's a history to this that we can learn from, and also that we can kind of, yeah, predict from, so to speak.
Mm-hmm. And then change the next chapter of those histories too. I mean, Tanya talks a lot about reclaiming a generative space that we can reclaim. And that's a really powerful idea to me there, because what resides in that is this idea of who gets to tell the stories. And for so long, I mean, this is to your point about like borders are there for many reasons. There are geopolitical reasons, there are historical reasons, sometimes there are safety reasons, but the people who have determined those borders are by and large not the people impacted by those borders, right? Like they're writing someone else's story by putting a border in that place. Now that the border having been put in place might predate the people who live by it and who are impacted by it daily by many, many, many years or generations. But I find the hopefulness in her work that there are other narratives to tease out of this thing that is a reality that's not likely to go away. And in some places maybe shouldn't go away. You know, like you said, they do exist for a reason, but this power to tell the story and being able to take that on is a really, a concept I look for in a lot of my kind of my favorite art. It really draws me in, but I think it's quite potent here.
Yeah, I would agree. And I kind of alluded to this ranking that I kind of inevitably do as a fellow artist when I see other artists' work. Usually it's comparing it to, you know, I realize it's comparing it to my own work. And so it's like, am I interested in what they're doing? But also it has to do with this kind of how open-ended and expansive and inviting and kind of dialogue creating is the work. And to me, all of them are kind of all of the artists here in the program are alluding to wanting that, but I don't think all of them succeed as much as the others. I feel like Tanya is really good at this kind of very like I'm going to kind of do this thing. I'm going to share my findings and we're going to talk about it. And I think there's a real strong history of that. And there's a real like art historical space for that. And I think, Raphael's work is the most exciting to me in that regard, where it's not only creating that space in the work, but it's creating, space for it aesthetically, even like those beams hitting each other, or hands, like his aesthetic gestures are so on the nose to the point where it doesn't bother me anymore. Like, it's just like, yes, that's what we need right now. It's like a radical kind of sincerity that mm-hmm. excites me. And then the other two artists, I mean, I think Post-Commodity was really kind of hitting it with some of the early work, and the one in Chicago is a little kind of, it's like a short story, whereas a lot of the other ones were novels. And then Ms. Rock's work to me felt a little not invested enough in a certain kind of, it's a conversation starter, but you know, where at a, maybe like at a nice cocktail reception. Yeah. But anyway, that was a long
Ms. Rock. The three of us talked about Ms. Rock last time we met, right? And there's, I think we all kind of took the same issue, which is that it verges on ruin porn at times. And there's this sort of like shock for the sake of being shocking. Now, some of that shock does come from aesthetic value. Like some of those images are really incredible. The one with the, I think it's like a lettuce field right next to the wall is a really beautiful, like, kind of image. And there's like the dramatic mist. Like he knows that these are going to catch your eye. He knows that looking at a pair of empty shoes in the sand are going to elicit a very specific kind of shocked response, right? And I think that I don't know, his I really take issue with his work.
When you see those ones, especially like the remnants of, you know, migrants in the desert, they're just so far removed from the story. And I think that's when I saw Kevin's photographs that he took of basically like very similar things, but there was this story of this one migrant attached to it, and reading that, like, you know, the sort of personalness I think is really important in those kinds of photographs. And I don't get that from him. And even when he does work with Guillermo and there's this, you know, sound component, which, you know, I'm interested in Guillermo's work in general, but like, I don't know, it still feels a little bit bizarre, like to pair them. I don't know, like in that gallery, I haven't seen that Border Cantos show. So I'm not really, you know, I might have a different feeling when I saw it in person, but yeah.
Yeah, I feel like Richard can't get beyond his own subjectivity. Yeah. You could say his own privilege. I find it ironic that he cites himself, of course, and he says that, you know, there was this moment when in his 20s where he thought he was going to change the world and it didn't work out. And I'm like, okay, and then what? You kept, but it helped his own career.
Yeah.
At least he acknowledges that.
Yeah. And the photographs are still doing that.
So, there was a great, I should have looked this up before the talk started. There was a great exhibition at the International Quilt Center down in Lincoln. Mm. This is a couple of years ago, and it was an artist who, I wish I could give you the whole story, but this artist had been working with a nonprofit that tried to identify people who had died in the process of trying to migrate across the border. They're called the desconocidos, like the unknowns, right? What the project became is collecting pieces of clothing that had been left behind, and then putting them into a quilt, assigning them a year. And there was a little more to it. And again, I'm sorry for being vague, but I encourage you, if you're interested, to look up this project at the International Quilt Center. But it was really powerful in a way, in the same way that Ms. Rock's photos of the similar objects feel quite vapid, empty. So I think there is a way to do that. There is a way to deal with those materials, but snapping a picture on your iPhone and being quite glib about it, frankly, does not feel like the path for that.
I mean, thinking about some sort of like quilt or weaving of those things makes it a completely different, I don't know, there's like something about having an artist's hands on them that even like adds to that, right? Or like having the care of like that object, like finding it, caring for it, assigning a year, like even that in its own like feels different than just being like click, you know, like, oh look, there's a shoe. So yeah.
And even, I mean, Raphael's work in contrast, I mean, I watched the extent, there's these extended cuts that Art21 has on their site. And you see a lot more of the behind the scenes with his work, and you see how many people are involved. And just so like, you know, there you're instantly introducing so many more perspectives into a work. The work becomes collaborative. It becomes inadvertently about that.
Yeah, and I think the one that he did, the Vos Altas, like, and you know, he had the former student who didn't go that day because he didn't have permission. Like, I mean, at that point, I was like tearing up. You know, I mean, it's just the interaction that I think, you know, his work, like, it's almost like he produces this work, which is so amazing, and then you watch him, like, he just kind of steps back and like lets other people interact with it, you know, and he might, yeah, like he pulled those women over and said, you know, put your hands here. But I think that there's something, you know, I feel like in his own personality of just like offering this way of like, almost like it's like cathartic, you know, it's healing. You know, that woman talking about how she hadn't seen her brother or her mother, and, you know, that other woman on the other end, just, you know, understanding that. And the woman that runs the Rubin Center said something like, how to be human on a global scale. And I just feel like his work just does that. Like almost every time I see his work, I feel like it does that, you know, like especially these kinds of projects where there's this interaction. He's really like top notch.
Yeah. And I think it can be really quite poignant to kind of graft onto these existing social structures and acknowledge that there's already interaction, there's already kind of humanness happening in that space, right? That to me is very striking that he does take that step back. I had another point I was gonna make, but it totally went out of my head, so.
Do we have any questions or anything? Doesn't look like it. But I did say radical sincerity. Yes, I wrote that down too, Misa. Like,
I actually, as I said it, I was like, I think it's something when I was at SAIC that Michelle Grabner said. Mm. I think citing a certain kind of text, maybe a vague movement of some kind that like someone wrote as a call of it being like what we need right now with work. And I think to that point, like this contrast that we're talking about, you know, you can't get to that kind of radical sincerity if you're still invested in art making that I see Richard really invested in, and Raphael in contrast to, which is like the idea of like an artist as like this like mythological like person that's going to give us all the answers. Like, I'll never forget what's his name, the name just escaped me, but it was a very famous artist that I met a couple of years ago. And basically he was like, yeah, like we need to stop that. Like we need more so this idea of like, I think an artist as a director or an artist as like, just like kind of a seat at the table. Like just give us a seat at the table. Let's hear their perspective, but let's not expect more or less of anyone really. I mean, we can look at what happened yesterday as like a clear example of what happens when we put someone on a pedestal that nobody deserves to be on a pedestal.
Yeah, and I think that you make a very good point by saying we've put them on a pedestal, because in some ways, and really this is like the truly the story of American art since 1945, is that we've placed this responsibility. We place this burden on artists to like be better than, to see more clearly than, to open our eyes more, you know, like all of these things that we look to for art. And yes, maybe we should look to art for those things, but with the acknowledgement that the artist and the art he or she or they are making is part of a network. It's not in a bubble, and we're not going to just be able to like suck something out of it and walk away with it, right? It's a part of the story.
Yeah, look, you said it was like, look to the art, not the artist, you know? And I think, you know, what Raphael's doing is art that is made by many people. And even Tanya, like, I don't know how she's necessarily presenting the work, but I see it as embodied research. I don't necessarily see it as like, I'm gonna find the answers and then everyone's gonna, you know what I mean? Like it's a conversation.
Yeah, she definitely has like it's very collaborative, it seems like, her work too. So.
Yeah. And there's a bit of a generational divide. I mean, Mizrock is for sure an old white guy. I mean, we already talked about privilege. I mean, he's got about all the privileges he can handle. But, you know, the other artists are of the next generation down. And there's this sort of, there was a reconsideration of the ego somewhere between his generation and their generation. And I think you see a little bit, I'm not taking responsibility off of him. I think that he needs to own, like you said, his subjectivity a little more. But I do think that like, he's a little bit of a product of the system as well.
Yeah. We do have one question here. What do we see locally that aligns with the best of this work? Quickly, anybody have a suggestion?
I would say locally here in Omaha, you know, right outside the Bemis, I'm not taking credit for this at all, there is a community garden that popped up about 2 years ago called the Sacred Seed. And I think that, you know, and it'll be continuing, and Bemis is one of the partners as well as a couple of other places. And, you know, something like that where there is this sort of sharing of knowledge in terms of local and indigenous plants and vegetables and fruits and flowers. There's a space for sharing. There's, you know, obviously because of COVID, there was a lot less programming that happened this summer, but I think next summer going into it, there will be more. We'll be doing a collaboration with them. I think something like that, you know, there's so many amazing places here that are doing such great work. But yeah, that was the first thing that popped into my mind when I saw that. So.
Most of what the union does, I mean, that's sort of a vague answer, but like it's sort of at the core of their mission, right, is to find the humanity in art and connect communities. And acknowledging that the artist is a human and part of the community. I mean, I think this is something that I had was interesting when I first moved to Omaha, because it at that time, this was going on almost 9 years now, it was a very different kinds of arts community. And I found that people had trouble connecting with the idea that art is really made under your nose. And I'm talking about like your typical museum goer, which is a very different audience than most of the people who are sitting here right now, right? But being able to connect the art that people were looking at to the people making it and making those human connections is something that the union does very well. And I think speaks to what Sally's asking about.
Great.
And I think you hit on the word that we've all related to the best of this work is community and the participation of the community in the work in some way or another. Mm-hmm. And we really hope to be able to offer more of that through the Holy Family Community Center. That is what we are truly trying to build, as a place for access for everyone to share and hear stories. So thank you everyone for joining us tonight and watching and sharing your thoughts. We're going to continue the discussion online. We had so many topics that have come up that we didn't get to talk about. I'm going to just open a discussion board and look for more screenings in the future.
Great. Thanks, Lori.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming tonight.
Bye, everyone.